So, my dear brothers and sisters, I am very happy to address you this Lenten season. And the Lenten season is always a special season for us. From last year's Lent, it has been all the more special because of the Corona atmosphere. It's as good as the cross is in front of us, the cross is behind us, the cross at the side of us. I was just thinking what I could speak about today. And since the Lenten season is the season of the cross in a very special way, I thought perhaps I could base my reflections on the cross of Christ. I have just recorded a small bit now in Kannada on the stations of the cross, the second station actually. The second station, as you know, is Jesus accepts his cross. So I ask myself, what is the meaning and symbolism of the cross for us? I would restrict myself to four small thoughts about the cross or reflections on the cross. First of all, the cross of Christ is a sign and symbol of God's greatest love for us. Now, secondly, Christ is the means by which, cross is the means by which we are healed of our wounds. Thirdly, the cross of Christ is always a sign of glory and reflection of his greatest appreciation for us. And finally, for us priests and religious, and especially the faithful, the cross is the sign of our identity. First of all, as I said, the cross is a sign of God's greatest love. You know that beautiful verse in the Bible, John chapter 3 verse 16, God so loved the world that he sent his only son to die for us, so that whoever believes in him is really saved. So therefore it was God's wish that Jesus should accept the cross for our sake. Colossians chapter 2 verse 14, we hear, he cancelled the record of our debt that stood against us by nailing it to the cross. So therefore it was Jesus' intention to show us the love of God to us by accepting and dying on the cross. For us, perhaps the cross has got a negative meaning. It's not only, the cross in English language is almost synonymous to trouble, to struggle, to something that we should throw off or get rid of. When I say I have a cross, it means that I have a big problem that is on my shoulders. When I say that you are a cross for me, it's as good as to say that you are a big, big burden for me. And many a time, these what we think or consider as burdens of the cross, are God's greatest gift of love to us. You know, many years ago, I was visiting a family as a priest, and it happened to be a non-Christian family. I did not know them. So just as I entered the house, they welcomed me, of course, very nicely. They had known me because the house was not very far off, and they were passing the church almost every day and say, Father, please come. The sight of mine was of a child that was sitting in a very covered or a sort of a folded stance in a corner. I slowly realized that this was a child, a specially able child, that was suffering from certain seizure, and the condition of the child was that it could not move. It was just a bundle of a muscle as it was. And I asked, how old is this child? And they told me, it's not a child. It's almost 21 years old. Just a bundle. just a bundle sitting in the corner. You could see the eyes popping out. It wasn't a very good scene for me. And having nothing much to say, I just uttered and said that this child must be a big burden for you. You know, the mother smiled at me and she said, yes, we thought so in the beginning. But now this child, we consider it as a special blessing for us. I was shocked. How can this child be a blessing to them? And then the woman recalled her story and said that, you know, the year we were married, my husband was working in the factory, and I was also a typist somewhere close by, and both of us were leading our own life, but within 6 months, we were fed up of each other. We were fighting so much, and then we thought the best thing would be for us to divorce our marriage. We had come to that point. And this is the time I recognized that I was pregnant. And my husband kept postponing signing the papers. And ultimately he said that, okay, since the child is ours, I will do it after the child is born. The child was born. And see the condition. That was how she was born. She has grown a little, but this is the bundle of flesh that was in my stomach. A specially able child. But my husband in the beginning, he could not go away from me because he also knew this is a burden or this is whatever you want to say. And he stuck to me. I stuck to him. And today, after 22 years of our marriage, if we are still together, it's because of this child. I understood what's the meaning of sometimes crosses for us. Crosses of Jesus that are given to us, that we many a times perhaps we don't understand. Secondly, as I said, the cross is a sign and symbol of healing. Who says that? When sickness comes, we try to find the medicines. But do we realize that sicknesses are ways of also healing within us certain things that we have taken for granted? Perhaps I am a sugar patient. And that sickness of sugar, extra sugar, the sickness tells me that I should control it. Or perhaps there is something else in my life that is lacking, which is shown to me through a sickness. Much more than this, the cross of Christ is a big healing. St. Peter tells us in his reading in the chapter 2, verse 24, Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that he might die to sin. That's true. But then by his wounds we are healed. The healing of Christ through the cross. And many, many people have realized it. You know, recently I met a patient. He was about 45, maybe 50 years. And a very busy man. He's a CEO in one of the offices. And so busy that he didn't have any much time for himself. And he was rushing, pushing. And he was a sort of a salesman type. He had to get orders for his company. And he was desperate to get more and more so that he can increase his income. And naturally, he neglected his family also. Unfortunately, he was in corona. And because of corona, he was not only put in the hospital, but afterwards, so much so that what we call the quarantine for a long time, his family was not coming. His companions and his work bosses were just phoning up to him. And in his isolation, he says, I learned many lessons of my life. That I had taken for granted my health. That I had taken for granted my time and energy that was given to me. And I thought I was the ruler of my life. But these days on the bed, these days of isolation, has surely been a sort of healing for me. I don't blame anybody. I don't even blame my family because that would be a bigger burden if they also got infected with this disease. I'm not sorry they didn't come to see me. But then I know how I would have to look at others when they get sick, and how I would have to look at myself. And therefore the cross of Christ is also a sign of healing for us. You know, I was reading a small book wherein it is said, Saint Ignatius who says, you want to be happy? Ask for crosses. Because crosses will give you certain solutions for your life, which all the other things in your life may not give. No books will give you. No sermons can give you. No, perhaps not the even the experience can give you. But a cross, a trouble, a struggle, a sickness, a loneliness, these are the things that will teach you and also bring a sort of healing about you. Thirdly, as I said, the cross is the sign and symbol of the exaltation of our life in Christ. I think it's Saint Louis de Montfort said, may God give you more and more crosses, he says. Because this particular saint not only suffered in his own community, but also the isolation from the others. And in everything that he had, he blessed God. He was a great lover of Mother Mary and therefore of the Rosary. And so every mystery, when it came alive to him, he said that, I glorify in the cross of Christ. How beautifully we sing that hymn, Hail the Cross. Because to the cross, we win our victory before Christ. Saint Teresa of Avila used to say, look at the barren cross. Because when the cross is barren, you can ask Jesus to crucify me on that cross. Because through the cross alone, I can get victory. You know, St. Paul has got a certain type of theology which is very difficult to understand. In one of his letters, Galatians, he says, the cross of Christ is folly for many people. It's scandal for the Jews. It's shame for so many people. But for me, for being saved, it is the power of Christ. The cross is a power. The cross is a victory. But far from it, for me to boast, says St. Paul in Galatians chapter 6, by which, in the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified, and I to the world. St. Paul seems to say that his success is because of the cross. If there was no cross in his life, surely perhaps he would not be not only able to boast, but also boast of his victory. In Rome, when you visit all the churches, you have that beautiful church of what's called San Pietro in Vincoli, where St. Peter and perhaps St. Paul also were put into chains, Vincoli's chains. And in that church, where St. Paul and perhaps St. Peter also received their disciples, and it seems they used to shake their hands with these chains that they had and said, these are the chains that have chained us to Christ. And therefore we are proud of it. It's because of these chains we have come to you. You know, Peter and Paul traveled all the way from Jerusalem to Rome, and they were persecuted. They were crucified upside down, whatever it is, in Rome. So therefore the cross of Christ is a source of exaltation for us. Finally, I ask myself, what is the cross for me? What's the cross for us priests? As shepherds, we not only carry our cross, but we carry the cross of the others. How often it does happen that someone does a wrong and you are blamed for it. Sometimes how even for our parents in our families, the child does something, the son does something that is shameful, the daughter does something that is not bearable, but the parents have to suffer. We say we carry the cross of others. There's something called vicarious cross. Vicarious in the sense, I have not done anything. I have not been cause of anything that is wrong, but then I carry the cross of others. I carry the cross, the burden of the others. I was visiting a family and I saw that woman in the house who was taking care of her father. The father must have been 80, 85, 90, almost bedridden. She was a nurse. She gave up her job. And she says, "This is my only father. And I know that I would have earned much. I could have kept a woman and we tried it for a long time. But then not only we didn't succeed, as I said to myself, this is the time I have to repay my debt to my father by serving him till death." And therefore she sacrifices herself. She takes upon herself the cross of Christ. In that sense, the saying of Jesus, "Take up your cross and follow me. If anyone would like to come after me," says the Gospel of Mark, "let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. Because whoever does not take up his cross is not worthy of me," says the Gospel of Matthew chapter 10. Today's, we have a beautiful gospel. Today's date that I'm giving this talk is 21st of March, Sunday. And we have a beautiful gospel today. And in the gospel, as we know that, Philip is meeting certain people who want to know more about Jesus. And Philip brings them to Andrew. Perhaps he's not very confident about meeting Jesus. And both of them take these people, these Greek Christians or perhaps not Christians, to Jesus. And Jesus says, "The Son of Man has to be glorified. But before that, he has to die, suffer, enter into the glory." And the example that is given for us, Jesus says that we do not say directly that we have to die, but he gives the example of the grain of wheat. Unless the grain of wheat dies, it does not bear fruit. Inasmuch as it dies, it bears fruit, and fruit that is everlasting. That's our life. That's the meaning of the cross. That each of us is called upon to take up our cross and follow Jesus. And in that not only lies our salvation, but the salvation of others. Perhaps it's my own cross. Perhaps it's my own suffering. Perhaps it's the cross that I brought upon myself through my sinfulness, or perhaps through my accident. I saw a youth recently and I went to the hospital. He was in the other bed. He smiled at me and I asked him and said, "Father, what to say?" At night, I was going on a motorbike. I was going so fast that I didn't see the hump, and I went and broke my knee. And they told me they cannot repair my knee. I'll have to be on the crutches for all my life. He was smiling. Perhaps he understood that no one is responsible, that he himself. But then this is the cross of Christ. This is the cross of Christ. Carlo Coretti, in his book, "On a Desert Experience," gives a beautiful example that he wanted to cross the desert as a mystic and beautifully perhaps contemplate about life. He says on the first day, there was a long, long distance. You know, the desert is hundreds of miles, which he wanted to conquer, which he wanted to cross, and perhaps boast and write more in books. Carlo Coretti has written many books. But on the first day itself, something happens. He twists his ankle, falls down, and never again can he walk again. But then he says, "That was the greatest lesson for me. That what was important was not my crossing the desert with pride and with vigor, but to stoop and stumble and to walk on my knees, or I would say sticks, but at the same time be thankful to God for this cross which has made me humble." Perhaps that is what we need. So my dear brothers and sisters, as I said, first of all, the cross is a sign of God's greatest love. Let's try to understand it. Cross is not a punishment. Cross is nothing that is a curse that is laid upon us, but rather, just as God sent his only Son so that through his act of dying on the cross, God shows us the greatest love. Secondly, as I said, there is also understand that the cross is sign and symbol of our healing. We are sick. In this Lenten season, perhaps more and more things come to our fore. That I have been sinful, I have been selfish, I have been lustful, I have been hateful. And these are the things that I need to be healed of. And the cross of Christ, the physical crosses, the mental crosses, the psychological crosses, perhaps can bring about a lot of healing when I accept and embrace the cross of my life. The cross is, thirdly, as I said, the cross is sign and symbol of God's greatest glory and our victory too. If Christ succeeded, and if St. Paul says, the cross of Christ is a sign and symbol of my own victory, and though it's a folly that it's shameful for the others, but for me, without the cross, I could not think of being a follower of Christ. And finally, for each one of us, whether we are priests, whether we are religious, whether we are members of the family, God asks us to accept our cross. Because through this cross that we carry every day of our life, perhaps God is coming. Not we are not moving towards God, but God is coming closer to us. Many of us find it troublesome, and perhaps we have asked the Lord so many times to remove the cross away from us. Surely Jesus himself prayed. In Gethsemane he said, take this chalice away, but then not my will, your will be done. Your will be done. And therefore, let our life's philosophy be that if God has allowed his crosses, if God doesn't want to remove his crosses, perhaps God wants to do miracles in my life through these crosses. Let us not pray to Christ who is crossless, just as many of us perhaps pray to Christ without the cross. We say we want the Christ, we like to see the image of Christ, we like to see the baby Jesus, but then the cross frightens us. In this Lenten season, may we come more and more closer to Christ and his cross. God bless you.